Hey, good morning.
How you doing, Brad? Well, this has not turned out to be a great week for Mitch McConnell.
That's right. And you heard such confidence earlier in the week from Mitch McConnell. We will have a vote. It will happen this week. We're going to get this thing passed. In fact, we were speaking to his number two, John Cornyn, just a couple of hours before all this went down. He said, I'm confident that this bill is going to pass this week. Well, 2 hours later, we'd been told that there was not even going to be a vote because there were senators out there, GOP senators, who didn't just want to vote no on the bill. They wanted to vote no on even moving it to the floor.
What happened? How did things go so wrong for this group in the GOP?
Well, what happened so quickly, I think, what changed everything overnight was that CBO score, right? Was when you actually have in black and white a bipartisan group saying that this would put 22 million people off with health insurance. Now, the White House has argued whether those numbers are always accurate, but for senators who are off, you know, who are used to using those same numbers to go up to people and say, my bill will create this many jobs or my bill will save this much taxpayer money, they have to go on these numbers. That's all they've got. And so when those numbers came out, that's when you had the straw that broke the camel's back. Susan Collins, Rob Portman, Shelley Moore Capito from West Virginia, that's when they all come out and said, I just can't vote for this bill.
The bill was prepared in secret. And I think that that's everyone agrees that it was not a bipartisan approach. It wasn't even a united party approach. Is that coming back to haunt Mitch McConnell and the group that kind of gathered together in secret and put this piece, this bill together?
Well, that's the thing. I think that if they had their wishes, I don't know if they would change anything about the secrecy to the outside world about what was in the bill, right? I mean, you're already seeing the results of what the publicity can do to a bill like this. Within minutes, you had a CBO score. You had the AARP saying, don't vote for this bill. Just overnight, we're seeing a new poll from NPR that shows just 17% approval for this bill, and that political momentum can kind of dwindle. So I think Mitch McConnell is fine with the idea of not letting, you know, Joe Q. American see this bill, but to not let other Republicans in the conference, in the caucus, Ted Cruz helped write the thing, and he's one of the people who says he's voting no on this.
Right.
I think that is a sticking point for many of these senators who felt like they just couldn't confidently vote yes or no yet.
Well, and I think that raises a great point, and you say that Mitch McConnell maybe doesn't want John Q. Public to talk about the new bill so that they can get it out there and pass it. I mean, it wasn't that the complaint about Obamacare was that I'm going to read it after I pass it. At some point, I think, you know, the American public and the Americans want to know in advance what their legislators are voting on.
Yeah, and I think there is sort of a widespread resentment whenever you talk about legislators who say, we'll let you know, just trust us.
Right.
That I think a lot of people, that strikes them the wrong way. I mean, there was some credence to the idea then, as there is now, that you really do not always, you cannot always necessarily game out exactly what will happen. I think that was what Nancy Pelosi originally meant by we'll find out what's in the bill after we pass it. and that continues to be the case with Republicans. But when you see one group saying about the other one that, you know, that this is absurd to say, and then they turn around and do the same thing, that's what also strikes people as hypocritic.
Correct. What's next? Where do we go from here?
Well, it's really anyone's guess, because now you've got a week for senators to go home, look at the bill, and Mitch McConnell wants them to come back with actual language that they could use to amend the thing. And it's very possible that with some of these moderates, with Susan Collins, with Dean Heller from Nevada, that they could come back and say, you know, behind closed doors, I guess I can vote for the bill as long as you throw in something there that I can at least take back to my constituents and say, look at how much better I made this bill. So you could imagine that happening. It's also equally easy to imagine your Rand Pauls and Ted Cruz's just being so diametrically opposed to your Susan Collins and your Dean Hellers that they cannot come to a solution that gets them 50 votes. And that's a real possibility that President Trump, shockingly yesterday, said at the end of the day it would be tough, but he'd be fine with.
Isn't it going to be hard, as you said, for Susan Collins to go back, or Dean Heller, states that were heavily invested in the Medicaid expansion under Obamacare, and they're going to say, well, as long as that doesn't impact, it doesn't impact us at that level, the Medicaid level, where you have Ted Cruz and the others saying we have to reduce significantly the participation in the what we put into Medicaid. Those two can't coincide.
I was going to say, and they have different constituencies too, right? I mean, Ted Cruz really did campaign for the last several years on this idea of we are going to fully replace and repeal, fully repeal and replace the Affordable Care Act. Susan Collins, I don't think, is necessarily hearing the same thing from her voters. In fact, this NPR poll that came out overnight said not only does only 17 of Americans approve of the Senate health care bill, it also said only 17 Americans approve of the Affordable Care Act. But that's because almost 50% of Americans want the Affordable Care Act tweaked to do more, not less. So in many states across the country, and some of them are ones that voted for GOP senators, there are people who want the Affordable Care Act to get more expansive, not less. And so even though they're both in the same party, Ted Cruz and Susan Collins just responding to radically different voters.
Right. I think at the end of the day, sometimes people can't articulate or don't know. I mean, it's much like saying I voted against Hillary Clinton. Sometimes the equation of the Affordable Care Act with President Obama is so close that they oppose the Affordable Care Act because they opposed President Obama. But they can't really articulate why it is they dislike the Affordable Care Act. They know it provides insurance, and now they're trying to figure out a way. Everyone agrees that premiums are too high. Why can't we start? Why can't they say we're going to try and tweak this as opposed to just repeal and replace?
Yeah, I was about to say, Jay, besides the personalization of the idea of this really symbolizing President Obama and some people not liking that, there's also just the nuts and bolts of my premiums are too high. I'm getting a product that doesn't give me what I want. The problem that the CBO calls out is that the Republican plan does not necessarily make those problems better.
Right.
That it doesn't necessarily lower premiums, it doesn't lower deductibles, and it doesn't keep people on insurance that they consider safe. And so that is the major problem that Republicans are running into here. And so what it ends up looking like, I think, to a lot of people in the Beltway and around the country is it's just going to be a large cut to Medicaid. And, you know, say what you want about Medicaid, but there are a lot of people in this country that are on it, and that's what's going to make this problem very intractable because there's a lot of different groups that are affected right now.
Right. Brad Mielke, ABC News correspondent from New York. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jay.
It is 729 KTO.